When we scientifically advanced in astronomy, medicine, and physics, we replaced the old and outdated concepts of our mythic past with new and more accurate terminology which reflected our newfound understanding of our body and the universe at large. Thus, instead of talking about RE, the sun god, we talked instead about electrical magnetic currents. Thus, instead of talking about spirits as the causes of diseases, we talked about bacteria and viruses. Thus, instead of talking about tiny ghosts circulating throughout our anatomies pulling this or that muscle, we talked about a central nervous system. In sum, we eliminated the gods or spirits in favor of more precise and accurate physiological explanations. Hence, the term, eliminative materialism. As a materialistic explanation evolves over time, it will either eliminate or reduce hitherto inexplicable phenomena down from the celestial region to the empirical arena. And in so doing, help us to better understand why certain events transpire in our body, in our mind, in our society, and in our world. Eliminative materialism is reason writ large. The difficulty, though, is that we have allowed eliminative materialism to change our thinking about almost everything except ourselves. When it comes to understanding our own motivations, we have, as the Churchlands point out, resorted more or less to folk psychology, utilizing terms such as desire, motivation, love, anger, and free will, to describe what we believe is happening within our own beings. The problem with that as such terminology arises not from a robust neuroscientific understanding of our anatomies but rather arises from a centuries-old mythic-slash-religious comprehension of our very consciousness. And that's the rub. Where we have moved away from such religious goose-speak in the fields of physics, astronomy, chemistry, and biology, in talking about ourselves we are still stuck in pre-rational modes of discourse. Where astronomy reflects the latest theories of the universe, where medicine reflects the latest theories of diseases, in talking about ourselves we tend to reflect ancient theories of human psychology. We resist knowing ourselves as merely this body, this brain, this material. As Patricia so astutely put it, we don't want to be just 3 glorious pounds of meat. Well, according to eliminative materialism, that is precisely what we are. And in order to get a better understanding of human consciousness, neurophilosophy argues that we focus our attention on developing a more comprehensive analysis of the brain and how it creates self-reflective awareness. In so doing, we can then come up with a more neurally accurate way of describing what is going on within our own psyches, pun intended. Thus, instead of using the term soul, we might instead use phase-specific words to describe the current state of awareness which are more neurologically correlated. We have already done this slightly when it comes to headaches. Due to our increased attention to various pains and to the various drugs that are effective in treating them, we have become more aware of how to differentiate and thereby treat varying types of head pain. From Excedrin, very good for migraines because of the caffeine and aspirin combination, to Advil, very good for body and tooth aches. Hence, the neurophilosophical way to understand them ones is soul, to ground such ideas in the neural complex. What may transpire, as Francis Crick suggests in his aptly titled book The Astonishing Hypothesis, is that the soul will disappear. Why? Because there really is no soul. We are rather a bundle of neurons and nerve endings tied together in a huge neural complex that gives rise to consciousness. There is nothing meta, beyond, physical about us. We are physical. And that very insight will lead to a reinterpretation of who we are and why we are and how we are. At first this may get us a little depressed. Actually, it is a depression, since soul talk is inflationary in the first place. But even though we do encounter a deflation of sorts, especially when we have lived in an inflationary conception of our own personalities, it is replaced by something even more wonderful than our old outdated Greek, Egyptian, and Judaic/Christian myths. We are wonder tissue. And that in itself is as mystical or as profound as anything given in the Bible, the Quran, or the Guru Granth Sahib. How is that literal star projectile can congeal over time to evolve into conscious frozen bodies of light? We are frozen light reflecting now on where such light originated, and in so doing coming to grips with our real maker, our real creator. And who might that be? Superstrings in 26 dimensions? Virtual quantum caves? We already know the answer. We don't ultimately know. Hence, God or reality remains as before, unknowable. But at least in our progressive eliminative materialism we have liberated God from the confines of a tree, a rock, a river, a cross, a temple, a human being, a cosmos. Science is the great liberator of God. Now God can be as God has always been, the reality of what is. Whatever that may be. And we are rising in the midst of this infinity, don't know it. Now instead of talking about ourselves as souls, at least we can realize that I don't arise unless neurons orchestrate and play a certain symphony. We are neural surfers being lived by chemical electrical impulses emerging from the triune brain and beyond.